Welcome to Psychology of the Daf. We're on Shabbos, Daf Kufvav 106, and we're going to look at a part of the Gemara on 106b, Kufvav Amad Beis, which discusses the Tzipor Dror. In general, the Gemara is dealing with different types of animals and birds and what constitutes trapping, and it comes to discuss a type of bird who is literally a free bird, a Tzipor Dror. This free bird does not feel the need to be in any particular place in a home to be domesticated. It makes its nest in the wild, and it may occasionally be seen around human beings, but it's not like another kind of a bird that, you know, automatically returns to its coop or pen at the end of the day. Now, this Tzipor Dror is described by the Gemara as Eina Mekabelis Moros. It has no master. The Tana Debe Rabbi Yishmael, we have learned by the house of the Beis Medrash of Rabbi Yishmael, Lama Nikra Shema Tzipor Dror, why is it called a free bird? But the word Doror can be free, but also it has a consonance with the word Dar. Because it lives freely in the home as it lives in the field, meaning it's not tied down in any way. Ramban in Vayikra, Perek Yud Dalet, Pasuk Dalet, Ramban in Leviticus 14:4, he describes the Tzipor Dror as one that chirps a great deal. It's called Baalei Pitput. And pitput is an onomatopoeia, which means it makes a lot of chattering. It's not a held-back bird, and it's used in that way in the purification ritual of a mitzora, the Ramban suggests, because it has this quality of chattering. And just like it chatters, so too the mitzora needs to be reminded that in his or her Lashon Hara, in his or her gossiping, his chattering like a bird, he caused damage. Okay, then we have an interesting verse in Tehillim, Kapitel Pei Dalid, Pasuk Dalid, Psalms verse, chapter 84, verse 4, where it describes the Tzipor Dror, and it's describing that this free bird, even the free bird, finds its place in the house of the Lord, which begins to open up a discussion for us of who are we talking about over here? Is the Psalms really talking about a bird? The overall discussion of the overall content of that psalm is about the person becoming attached to Hashem, wanting to be attached to God. And it mentions that the free bird finds its home also in the temple by the altar. And that begins to give us as a hint as to what we might focus on in the nature and character of this free bird. Now, Ibn Ezra over there, he explains that this type of free bird has a particular quality. This type of free bird only sings when it's free. Now that is taking it one step further. So now this Tzipor Dror, this free bird, who, as the Gemara says, does not in any way recognize authority, is not held back and freely dwell in the home or dwell out in the wild. The Ibn Ezra goes further to say that this free bird, that is, as the Ramban says, represents just gossip and talking. This free bird, it only can sing when it feels free. If it is in captivity, if it's chained up, it is no longer free. This is what I'd like us to think about. There are some characters, there are some personalities who are free birds. They need to explore. They need to ask questions. They need to challenge authority. And the Pasuk in Tehillim is saying that even the free bird can find his or her place in the Beis HaMikdash by the Mizbeach. Hashem can even welcome the free bird. But let's keep in mind, in the context, what is the quality that the free bird has? It sings. The free bird sings. The free bird can only sing, according to Ibn Ezra, when it doesn't feel captured. But even that free bird, who could only sing when it doesn't feel, when it doesn't feel verklempt, which would you say in Yiddish, it doesn't feel all restricted, even that free bird, there's room for him in the Beis HaMikdash, there's room for him near Hashem, and he can sing there too. The other commentaries actually say that it's referring to the Levites, it's referring to the Levim who sing in the Beis HaMikdash. But combining the Ibn Ezra and the other commentaries, we're saying that the free bird can even be free with Hashem. And now that takes us to the personality type. A lot of times there are odd couples in marriages or even in parent-child relationships where you have one person who is much more free, much more impulsive, much more exciting, maybe an adrenaline junkie or some other type of person, and then you have the very serious, conservative, almost, you might even say, OCPD, which is not OCD, it's obsessive compulsive personality disorder. They need everything exactly so. They get uncomfortable when there's chaos, when there's disorder. They need to plan everything. Oftentimes, their emotions are much more restricted. Oftentimes, they can be cheap with their feelings and even cheap with their money. So you pair up an OCPD person with a tsipor drawer, with a free bird, what do you get? You get a lot of difficulty. Now, if it's a fight to the death, oftentimes the controlling personality wins over the tzipor drawer and gets the tzipor drawer to behave. If it's a parent-to-child relationship, same thing. If you have a parent that's much more authoritarian and much more rigid, and they have a child who is much more of the exploratory type, the tzipor drawer, the person who can't just make his nest in the home but needs to go everywhere and needs to sing, and you can use force and you can capture and control them, well, you can win in that way, but you're also losing, because Ibn Ezra says that the bird, the tzipor drawer that is captured and held in place, that tzipor drawer doesn't sing anymore. Only Hashem, who's big enough and broad enough and is not insecure and not defensive. Hashem could welcome the tzipor drawer into the Beis HaMikdash, even the free bird, even the free character, and that person can sing in the Beis HaMikdash too. How about that? But in relationships, this becomes a problem. So sometimes that restrictive person doesn't let the tzipor drawer breathe, and they think that they win. They win by clamping them down. They win by disciplining them. But then they don't sing anymore. Then they're depressed. And this happens in marriages, and this happens in parenting. And you know what happens then? Well, then they go and they take that person, not the one who ruined the life of the free bird, not the one that over-disciplined the child, not the one that restricted to the point of misery their spouse because they needed something in control. No, they take now the sick one, the tzipor drawer, the free bird who no longer sings, who's depressed, and they say, oh my gosh, look, they're depressed. They're terrible. I always knew they were mentally ill. I always knew they were crazy. And now they gotta stuff some medicine in them and all kinds of other crazy things. Maybe they have to send them away to boot camp. Maybe they have to put them in a hospital. Maybe they have to divorce them. You know, all kinds of good things, because after all, I mean, they're depressed, right? They're miserable. But what people don't get is they're depressed because you won. And by winning, you had to kill your enemy. And you killed the free bird. You were attracted to this person. You married this person because they had exciting qualities. You loved those qualities. You loved their impulsivity, their creativity. And then, boom, after you're married, and you started to be afraid that you can't control that person. Maybe they'll run away from you. Maybe they'll contradict you. Maybe they make you feel small because they're so much more emotionally powerful than you are. So what do? You clamp down on them and you make them miserable until they're depressed and ugly and dysfunctional. And then then you don't realize your sin. Oh, no. You don't realize your sin. No, you add insult to injury because what do? You say, they're sick. I always knew they were sick. And you try to fix them more with medicine, or you get rid of them, or you punish them, or you institutionalize them. But what you didn't do was you never respected their freedom. You never respected their voice. You never let them sing. You were too scared of their questions. You were too scared of what they might do. You were scared not of them. You were scared of yourself. You were scared of losing something. You were scared of losing control. You don't have to be afraid of them. Free birds don't hurt anybody. They're happy. They're happy to chirp. Hashem has no problem with them. Hashem says, come into my Beis HaMikdash. Sing away. We love your singing. We have no problem with you. All questions are entertained. We're not afraid. God is not afraid of anybody. He doesn't need anybody to protect his Torah. He's not worried about questions people are going to ask. He's not worried about complaints people are going to have. He's fine with all that. He just wants people to understand. And he will help them understand by getting close to them and loving them, not by smashing them and disciplining them. But that's what people do sometimes to the free bird. So I hope that you're not one of those people that I was talking to. In fact, I'd like to think that most people are not that way, but we must remember the free birds. We must respect the free birds. We must let the free birds roam. We must let the free birds chirp. We must let them talk. We must let them find their way, because if we do, and if we respond to them with love and care and respect, number one, we're going to have the delightful, delightful company of a happy, flying around bird, just like Hashem will have this delightful company of the Tzipor Dror and his Beis HaMikdash. And yes, we're going to have to live with the fact that they fly around. And we're going to have to live with the fact that we don't know what they're going to do next. So we can't yell at them or punish them or shame them. We can talk to them. We could ask them, would you like to stay? We could point out the value of staying. They found their way to the Beis HaMikdash. They know what's good. They know how to find the right things. We could say, here's what's so great about being connected to us. Here's what's so great about Yiddishkeit. We'd love for you to join us. We know that sometimes you have a very strong wanderlust and you can't always make your nest here. I'm okay with that because I know you need to be free sometimes. But I love you and I value your company and I value the excitement that you bring with your singing voice. So, free bird, come. Live with me in the Beis HaMikdash. Live with me by the Mizbeach. Live with me as much as you can. And when you need to fly about, I'll understand that too.